Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the new lecture on pharmaceutics, the dosage form science. I am Shoaib Muhammad, lecturer in the Department of Pharmaceutics, Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Sindh. In the current lecture, we will be discussing about the gels and magmas. The material for this chapter has been taken from NCELS Pharmaceutical Dosage Forms and Drug Delivery System. So this is the outline of the current lecture. In this lecture, firstly, we will be having the introduction to the gels and the magmas. Then we will go for the terminology that is used in gels and magmas. Then we will go for the classification, preparation, gelling agents, and certain examples of the gels and magmas. So by definition, gels are semi-solid systems consisting of dispersion made up of either small inorganic particles are large organic molecules enclosing and interpenetrated by a liquid. So if we talk about the state of the dosage forms, these are basically the semi-solid systems, and the particles are dispersed in a dispersing medium. Now, as these are the dispersions, these dispersion may be consisting of the small inorganic molecules or large organic molecules. We have to be to consider the size of the particles as well. So the small inorganic molecules and large organic molecules will make the dispersions for the gels and the magmas. And in this kind of the preparation, the dispersing medium is present in such a way that it may be present surrounding the particles and it may be present inside the particles. So it is a complete network of the dispersing phase and the dispersing medium. The gels can also be defined as semi-rigid systems in which the movement of the dispersion medium is restricted by interlacing three-dimensional network of particles or solvated molecules of the dispersed phase. That means the gels are formulated in such a way that the composition of the dispersed phase is not allowing the dispersion medium to flow freely. That's why these are the semi-rigid systems. If we talk about the appearance of the gels and magmas, gels is and magmas may be clear as water. We can see through it. These are transparent. However, in other situations, these may be turbid. Now, if the dispersed phase is completely mixed up with the dispersion medium, okay, we can see through it may be as clear as water. But if the molecules are not completely dispersed, and in some situations they may forming the aggregates, so the this will disperse the light, and as a result the appearance of the preparation will be turbid. Now, based on to the properties, these preparations can be classified into two major categories. Number one are the single phase gels, and number two are the two phase gels. The two phase gels are actually called the magmas. If you go into the definition of this each category or the properties of this each category, the single phase gels are those preparations in which the macromolecules are distributed so that no apparent boundary exists between them, and the liquid are called as the single phase gels. Now, if we make a preparation and we don't find separation between the dispersed phase and dispersion medium, there are no separate boundary lines which are separating these two major portions of the preparations, these will be like clear liquids, and then we call them as single phase gels. While the two phase gels, the gel mass consists of flocules of small distinct particles. The gel is classified as two phase gel and frequently called as a magma or a milk. Now, if we make a preparation and there is clear segregation between the dispersion dispersing phase in the dispersing medium, and we observe the presence of the flocules or small particles inside the preparation. So this is showing two phases of the preparation. That's why we are calling them as the two-phase gels. In other situations, or more commonly, we call them as the magmas or a milk. Gels and magmas are considered colloidal dispersions, or we can call them as the colloidal preparations, because they contain particles of colloidal dimension. The particle size of the dispersed phase will be in the range of 1 nanometer to 1 micrometer. Now we have different types of the colloids, and the different types of the colloids will affect the preparation of the gels and the magmas. So we have three types of the colloids. One are the lyophilic colloids, others are lyophobic colloids, and are the amphiphilic colloids. The gels of lyophilic colloids are easily prepared, and their viscosity increases with increasing the dispersed phase. Now, as the name indicate, lyophilic, lyo means solvent, philic means to love. So these colloids are solvent loving. So these, because of that, these are easily prepared. And as we increase the quantity of the dispersed phase, the viscosity of the preparation will also increase. However, the gels of lyophobic colloids are difficult to be prepared spontaneously. Neither the dispersion medium affects viscosity. Now, as the name indicates, these are lyophobic. These do not like the solvent. So these are difficult to be prepared. And in these preparations, if we increase the quantity of the dispersion medium, the dispersed phase, its viscosity will not increase. If you add certain quantity of the dispersed phase, there will be a certain limit of the viscosity, and after that limit of the viscosity, if even we increase more quantity of the dispersed phase, there will be no increase into the viscosity. Finally, we have the amphiphilic colloids. These may or may not become greatly solvated. Okay, sometimes these may be easily added into the dispersion medium. Sometimes they may not be easily added into the dispersed medium. They generally increase the viscosity in some of the situations. Or maybe with the increase of the addition of the dispersion medium, their concentration is also increased. Now we have some of the terminologies related with the gels and the magmas. These include imbibation, swelling, senescence, thixotropy, and zero gel. So firstly, imbibation. It is the taking up of certain amount of liquid without measurable increase in volume. In some of the situations, the gels may take up some of the water from the environment, and after taking that moisture from the environment, there will be no increase or no increase in the volume of the preparation. The volume of the preparation will be same. This is called as the imbibation. Next, swelling. It is taking up of liquid by a gel with an increase in volume. Now, if a gel takes up liquid from the surrounding, or maybe a liquid is added to the preparation, after the addition of that liquid, the volume of the preparation will increase. This is called as swelling. If the after the addition of the liquid or taking up of liquid, the volume of gel does not increase, it's called as imbibation. While after the addition of liquid, if the volume of the gel increases, we call it as the swelling. Next is senescence. Senescence occurs when the interaction between particles of the dispersed phase becomes so great that on standing, the dispersion medium is squeezed out in droplets and the gel shrinks. Now in this situation, the interaction between the dispersed phase, the particles that are dispersed into the preparation, if there is more interaction, if they have more interaction with each other, they will come up closer with the each other, and eventually the moisture or the liquid is present in between them or inside them will come out, and this moisture or liquid will appear as we say the droplets onto the preparation of the gel. Next we have thixotropy. Thixotropy is a reversible gel sole formation with no change in volume or temperature. Now in thixotropy, if we shake up a gel preparation or if we apply force onto the gel preparation, it will be converted into a solution or a free flowing liquid. But if we leave it for some time, again it will be converted from a solution to a gel, a semi-rigid form. Okay, and during this process there is no change into the volume of the preparation, neither there is no increase into the temperature of the preparation. There is just conversion of a semi-solid preparation into a liquid preparation, and after some time, if we leave the preparation for some time, it will again convert into the semi-rigid form, that is the gel form. Now this is basically a non-Newtonian phenomenon, and we can also call it as the non-Newtonian flow. Finally, we have zero gel. A zero gel is formed when the liquid is removed from a gel and only the framework remains. Now, if we remove all of the dispersion medium or all of the liquid from the preparation and only the dispersed phase in a network form remains, this is called as the zero gel. Now the classification of gels and magmas. The gels and magmas can be classified by two schemes. The table on this slide shows the scheme 1. In this scheme, the gels and magmas have been firstly classified into the two major categories. Number one is inorganic and other is organic. The inorganic gels are basically two-phase systems. We have already discussed about the two-phase systems. These have clear boundaries and we can distinguish between the dispersed phase and the dispersing medium. The examples of the inorganic or two-phase systems include the aluminum hydroxide gel and bentonite magma. In next class, the organic gels, we can also call it as the single-phase system. These may be appear as clear liquids. The examples of this class include the carbopol and tragacanth that are used as excipients in different type of the preparations. The table on this slide shows the scheme 2 for the classification of the gels and magmas. By this scheme, the gels and magmas firstly can be classified into the two major categories. Number one are the hydrogels and others are the organogels. The hydrogels have been further classified into the three categories. Number one are organic hydrogels. The examples of organic hydrogels includes pectin paste, tragacanth jelly. Next are natural and synthetic gums. The examples include methyl cellulose, sodium carboxy methyl cellulose, and pleuronic. The third category of hydrogels include the inorganic hydrogels. These include bentonite gel, V-gum, and silica. The organogels have been further classified into the hydrocarbon type. The examples include petrolatum, mineral oil, polyethylene gel, that is also known as the plasti base. Next category is the animal or vegetable fats. The examples include lard and cocoa butter. Next category of organogels is soap base greases. The examples include aluminium stearate with heavy metal mineral oil gel. Next category of organogels include hydrophilic organogels. Examples include the carbovax bases, that is the polyethylene glycol ointment. The other categories of organogels include the polar and non-ionic. Next, we have the preparation of gels and magmas. The gels and magmas can be prepared by two methods. Number one is the precipitation of the dispersed phase, and next is the hydration of the inorganic chemical. So the first method is preparation by precipitating the dispersed phase. Some magmas and gels that are inorganic are prepared by freshly precipitating the dispersed phase to achieve a fine degree of subdivision of the particles and gelatinous character to those particles. The desired gelatinous precipitate results when solution of inorganic agents react to form an insoluble chemical having high attraction for water. As the microcrystalline particles of the precipitate develop, they strongly attract water to yield gelatinous particles, which combine to form the desired gelatinous precipitate. So in this method, we are simply using the process of precipitation. We are adding the dispersed phase, okay, into a dispersion medium, and in that process the formation of precipitate occurs, and that precipitate can be used as a dispersion medium. Other gels and magmas may be prepared by directly hydrating the inorganic chemical which produces the dispersed phase of the dispersion. So in this process, we are simply adding the dispersed phase into the dispersion medium, and by which there is hydration of the dispersed phase and there is gel formation. In addition to the water vehicle, other agents such as propylene glycol, propyl gallate, and hydroxypropyl cellulose may be used to enhance the gel formation. On long standing, a supernatant layer of the dispersion medium develops, but the uniformity of the preparation easily re-established by moderate shaking. So as with the suspensions, if we keep them for some period of time, there is separation of the the particles or the settlement of the particles, which can be overcome by slight shaking. So similarly, if there is supernatant layer formation of the dispersion medium into the gels, we can overcome it by moderate shaking. So the preparations of the gels should have instructions for shaking well before use. The several of the preparations that of the gels that are available can be prepared by different methods. Here we are specifically discussing a preparation that is most commonly used, that is the milk of magnesia. Milk of magnesia is used in the treatment of the acidity and in the treatment of the constipation. The milk of magnesia is a preparation containing 7% to 8.5% of magnesium hydroxide. The preparation can be made by a reaction between sodium hydroxide and magnesium sulfate. Diluted solutions being used to ensure a fine, flocculent, gelatinous precipitate of the magnesium hydroxide. The precipitate so prepared is washed with purified water to remove the sodium sulfate prior to incorporation with additional purified water to prepare the required volume of product. As with the formulation of different type of the preparations, we add certain agent to enhance the formulation of the preparation. As in the emulsions, we add the emulsifying agents. In suspensions, we add the suspending agents. So for the gel preparation, we add gelling agents to enhance the formulation or enhance the preparation. The concentration of the gelling agents is mostly less than 10%, but usually it is in between 0.5 to 2% in range with some exceptions. The gelling agents that are used include the acacia, alginic acid, bentonite, carbomer, CMC sodium, cetosterol alcohol, colloidal silicon dioxide, ethyl cellulose, gelatin, guar gum, hydroxyethyl cellulose, hydroxypropyl cellulose, hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, magnesium aluminium silicate, maltodextrin, methyl cellulose, polyvinyl alcohol, povidone, propylene carbonate, propylene glycol, alginate, sodium alginate, sodium starch glycolate, starch tragacanth, and xanthan gum. Finally, we have the examples of gels and magmas that are commonly used. The gels and magmas can not only be used for the treatment of various ailments or the diseases, but these can be used as excipients in various of the formulation. One official magma called as the bentonite magma, formulated as per national formulary, is used as a suspending agent, and it finds application in extemporaneous compounding of prescriptions. Sodium fluoride and phosphoric acid gel that is formulated as per United States Pharmacopoeia is applied topically to the teeth and dental care prophylactic. So if you want to take care of the teeth and are to avoid any infection into the teeth or to maintain the hygiene of the teeth, we can use sodium fluoride and phosphoric acid gel. Next, we have the tretinoin gel that is formulated as per United States Pharmacopoeia. Is an irritant that stimulates epidermal cell turnover. It causes peeling and it is effective in the treatment of the acne. One another used gel include the fluocinonide gel that is prepared as per United States Pharmacopoeia. It is used as an anti-inflammatory corticosteroids and used in various inflammations. The other preparations of magmas and gels that are employed as antacids include the aluminium phosphate gel, aluminium hydroxide gel, and dihydroxyaluminium amino acetate magma that are prepared as per United States Pharmacopoeia. The milk of magnesia decreases stomach acidity and can also be used as laxative in the cases of the constipation. So this is all from my side regarding the gels and magmas. Thank you very much for your time.